Hello, and welcome to our fourth video tutorial on how to read and use VFR sectional charts as unmanned aerial system, or UAS, operators. This series of videos is brought to you by AmericaView, in partnership with the College of Natural Resources and Environment at Virginia Tech, the Virginia Cooperative Extension, and GeoTED UAS. My name is Daniel Cross, and I'll be your guide for this video. Today, let's talk about airspace. This is probably the most important information a sectional can impart to a UAS operator, since the different classes of airspace dictate where we can and cannot fly. Also, you will most likely have to answer a fairly large number of questions regarding airspace for your Part 107 exam. Many people find that reading airspace on sectionals is difficult, because the map is a representation of three-dimensional data, but it's only displaying it in two dimensions. To make this worse, the most complex airspaces are in the most cluttered parts of the map. To start with, there are six classes of normal use airspace. These classes are identified by a letter: A, B, C, D, E, and G. However, we won't worry about Class A airspace, since it starts at 18,000 feet MSL, far too high for most UAS. Of these classes of airspace, all but Class G are controlled airspace, which means we cannot legally fly there unless we hold a waiver granting us access. Let's start with Class G airspace. G is the good airspace, and is the most important class of airspace for us, since it's the only airspace we, as UAS operators, can legally fly in without special authorization. Also, it's the easiest to find on the map, since it doesn't have any symbology. This is because it covers most of the United States. On the map, Class G airspace is defined by the boundaries of other types of airspace. Unless modified by another airspace, Class G starts at the surface and goes up to 1,200 feet AGL, but cannot exceed 14,500 feet MSL. The next class of airspace is Class B airspace. Remember this airspace because B is for big. Class B is the busiest and most complex airspace, since it surrounds the largest airports, like Philadelphia International. This means that it's also the hardest to interpret on the map. Class B airspace is made up of a series of tiered rings that in cross-section look like an upside-down wedding cake. On the map, this is represented by solid blue concentric rings. Each ring is a layer in the cake, which steps upward as you move further from the airport. The changes in altitude for each ring are marked on the map by a fraction, which marks the ceiling or top of the airspace over the floor or bottom. These numbers are truncated to take up less space, so read them in hundreds of feet. As an example, 50 equals 5,000 feet. Now let's take a hard look at this example, starting in the center ring, which goes from the surface to 7,000 feet MSL. The next tier goes from 1,500 to 7,000 feet, and the tier after that from 2,000 feet to 7,000 feet. Then we have two irregularly shaped areas where the airspace is 3,000 to 7,000 feet. The last main ring is 3,500 to 7,000 feet. And finally, we have these two protruding areas where the Class B airspace starts at 4,000 feet and ends at 7,000 feet. The last bit is this solid magenta outer ring. This is a Mode C veil, which extends 30 nautical miles from the airport and indicates that aircraft flying in this area must have an altitude encoding transponder. However, most small UAS have been exempt from this requirement, since they have not been certified with an engine-driven electrical system. Most Class B airspace is covered by a TAC, or Terminal Area Chart, which is better for actual planning. However, you will most likely see several Part 107 exam questions asking about details in one of those Class B areas, and during the exam you will not have a user-friendly TAC to rely on. Continuing on, we have Class C airspace. Remember that C is for crowded. Class C airspace surrounds airports which have much more traffic than most, but not enough to warrant a Class B designation. This will include most regional airports, like Roanoke-Blacksburg Regional, Woodrum. The layout of Class C is very much like Class B, but the upside-down wedding cake is much smaller and less complex. On the map, Class C is marked by a solid magenta line. In this example, there is an inner circle with a partial outer ring that is split into two sections. Altitudes are marked just like they are with Class B. The inner tier is from the surface to 5,200 feet MSL. The outer tier goes from 3,400 feet to 5,200 feet, and the second outer tier starts at 3,800 feet and ends at 5,200 feet. Our next type of airspace is Class D. Remember this airspace since D is for dialogue because it's the lowest class of airspace that you must establish two-way radio communications to fly in. Class D is fairly simple since there is usually only a circle marked with a blue hashed line. Class D starts at the surface and goes up to the altitude marked in the box. Just like Class B and C altitudes, this number is read in hundreds of feet MSL. At Charlottesville, Albemarle, the Class D airspace goes up from the surface to 3,100 feet MSL. Recalling what we learned in the first video, many Class D airports have only part-time towers, and these will revert to Class E or G airspace when the tower is closed. The last controlled type of airspace is Class E, and E stands for everywhere else. The majority of Class E airspace does not get symbolized because it resides between Class G airspace and Class A airspace. However, Class E airspace has four special symbols where it gets modified. The first of the four symbols for modified Class E airspace is this magenta hashed line. This will either surround some of the busier, non-towered airports like Ingalls, or it will act as a less controlled extension of Class D airspace to protect an instrument landing path like we see here at Greenbrier Valley. In these areas, the Class E airspace starts at the surface and goes up to 18,000 feet MSL. Since Class E airspace is still controlled airspace, we cannot operate under Part 107 in these areas unless we have a waiver allowing us to do so. The second Class E symbol is this fuzzy magenta line, which fades inwards. This means that the Class E airspace on the lighter side of the line starts at 700 feet AGL. The third Class E symbol is this fuzzy blue line, which fades outwards. This means that on the lighter side of the line, the Class E airspace has a floor of 1,200 feet AGL, and on the darker side of the line, the Class E airspace starts higher up. This tends to be found out west and in Alaska, over very sparsely populated areas. The fourth and final Class E symbol is this blue zipper line. It means that the Class E airspace starts higher than normal. In this case, the Class E airspace starts at 1,300 feet MSL. And that brings us to the end of normal use airspace. Please continue to the next video in the series, where we will discuss special use airspace. Thank you for joining us, and fly safe.